Good morning and welcome to our online service from Bentley Baptist Church. It's great that you could join with us this morning. So today Joe will be bringing the word, concluding our series on journeying with Jesus. So we look forward to listening to that shortly. We're just going to start with a time of worship, but before we do, I'm just going to say a prayer. So Lord Jesus, thank you again for bringing us all together. Thank you for the love that you have for each one of us, Lord. And as we dive into your word this morning, may you speak to each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's start with some worship.
Remember those walls that we called sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we called death and grave. Like mountains that stood in our way, but he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He says stronger than the power of the grave. Constant in the trial and the change. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up. Ever been really disappointed or let down by somebody? And in today's story, we're going to look at an encounter with Jesus that took place the same day he rose from the dead. And in this story, two of his followers fail to recognize him. And then, having failed to realize that it's Jesus they're talking to, they share with Jesus the feeling that he let them down. Let's check this out. This is from Luke chapter 24, verse 13 onwards. It says, "The same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and he began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, 'What are you discussing so intently as you walk along?' They stopped, sadness written across their faces. And then one of them, Cleopas, replied,
You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that happened there in the last few days. What things? Jesus asked. Well, the things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth, they said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We'd hoped that he was the Messiah who'd come to rescue Israel, and this all happened 3 days ago. Then, they told him, some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they'd seen angels who told them Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, as the women had said. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people! You find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in Scripture. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory?" And then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the Scriptures the things concerning himself. Now, by this time, they were nearing Emmaus and the end of their journey, and Jesus acted as if he were going on, but they begged him, "Stay the night with us since it's getting late." So he went home with them, and as they sat down to eat, he took the bread and he blessed it. And then he broke it and gave it to them. Suddenly, their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. They said to each other, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the Scriptures to us?" And then within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 disciples and the others who'd gathered with them, who said, "The Lord has really risen. He appeared to Peter." And then the two from Emmaus told their story of how Jesus had appeared to them as they were walking along the road and how they'd recognized him as he was breaking the bread. In this story, the disciples missed who Jesus was. They were struck with a condition where they couldn't recognize him. Now, there's a scientific word for this. It's called prosopagnosia. Prosopagnosia. And the main symptom of prosopagnosia is having difficulty recognizing faces. You still see all the parts of a person's face normally, but when you've got prosopagnosia, all faces just look the same to you. They were struck with this inability to recognize Jesus. But they also failed to recognize who Jesus was, not just present there with him, but who he was in a more general sense. Look at their description of who Jesus was as they'd known him. They say he was a man from Nazareth, a prophet who did miracles, a teacher, and they hoped he was the Messiah who would rescue Israel. Was he just a man? Was he just a prophet? Was he just a teacher? Was he just even the rescuer of Israel? Jesus then unpacks the theology of the whole Old Testament, telling them all the places it refers to the Messiah in just 2 to 3 hours. That's how long the journey would have taken them. In 2 to 3 hours, Jesus unpacks the entire Old Testament, and everywhere it talks about him, the Messiah, and what he would do. In just 2 to 3 hours, Jesus helps these two followers see the big picture of who the Son of God really is. Jesus reveals that the Messiah is not just man, but he's God. He reveals the Messiah is not just a prophet who spoke for God, but the Messiah was God himself speaking. Jesus reveals that the Messiah wasn't a teacher bringing his version of the truth, but he was the very word of God, the way, the truth, the life. Jesus reveals that the Messiah didn't come to rescue and restore a country called Israel. He wasn't just a national hero, but he came to save all of humanity from sin, darkness, death, and separation from God. Jesus reveals all of these things to them. And then, when Jesus broke bread with them, an intimate act of sharing a meal they must have done with him countless times. When he broke the bread, he did it in such a way that they immediately knew it was him. The prosopagnosia is lifted and they declare, "Didn't our hearts burn within us when he explained the scriptures to us?" They realized he was not just a dead human prophet and teacher, but the Messiah, their savior, God the Son. And the transformation that Jesus is able to bring about in all our lives, just as he transformed their lives, just as their perspective was transformed in that moment, the transformation he can bring in our lives is directly proportional to who we believe he is. See, there are some people who don't even believe Jesus existed, and they will miss out on him because of their ignorance of the historical facts. Jesus' existence is a historically proven fact by historians by Jewish historians, by Roman historians, people who had no reason to say he existed if he didn't. And there are those who revere Jesus as a wise teacher or a philosopher, or even in Islam, they revere him as a prophet. And they might learn academic and philosophical truths from Jesus, but they'll miss out on the transformative power of a living relationship with him because he is alive. So who did Jesus say he was? If we look through the Gospels, did Jesus ever actually say that he was God? Well, in John 4:25-26, Jesus meets a woman at a well in Samaria, and he tells her that he is the Messiah. He says, "That is who I am." No vagary about it. That's what he says. And in John 8:58, a group of Jews are saying, Jesus claims to have known Abraham. And this group of Jews say, "What? How could you have known Abraham? That was thousands of years ago." And Jesus says this, "Very truly I tell you," Jesus answered, "before Abraham was born, I am." Before Abraham was born, I am. And in the Old Testament, when Moses first met God at the burning bush in the desert, he said to God, "What is your name?" And God said, "I am who I am." And so when Jesus said to these Jews before Abraham was born, "I am," Jesus was literally saying, "I'm God. Of course I knew Abraham." In Matthew 26:63-65, during Jesus' trial, before they nailed him to the cross, the high priest said to him, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." "You have said so," Jesus replied, "but I say to all of you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." And then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy." When Jesus said, "The Son of Man," that was an ancient name for the Holy One of God. And he said, "You'll see me at the right hand of the Mighty One coming on the clouds of heaven." As far as the high priests of Israel were concerned, these theologians of Israel, Jesus just said he was God. And then in John 14:6, Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He didn't say he knew the way to God. He didn't say he could tell people the way to God. He said he was the way to God because he is God. And when you know him, you Jesus said he was the Messiah. He was I am. He was the Son of Man who would return on the clouds of heaven. He's the only way to God. In the story that we read earlier about the two followers of Jesus on the road to Emmaus, Jesus proved who he was to his followers in four incredible ways that we can still experience today. First, he explained the evidence in the Old Testament to convince them. Secondly, he got to know them in a new way. He built a relationship with them as they journeyed together. Thirdly, he shared an experience with them by breaking bread to reveal his identity. They experienced his physicality, that he was real. And finally, he vanished from their sight to display his power. Jesus loves to connect with us personally, to help us know the truth about who he is. He wants us to know the evidence, have a relationship, experience him, and experience his power. But one of the key ways that people discover Jesus is when we, his followers, his disciples, share him with them. And we can do it in the same way. That's the mission that Jesus left with us, to make disciples of all nations. Christians are meant to share the evidence of Jesus' resurrection. Christians are meant to build relationships with the lost and the broken. Christians are meant to invite people to experience Jesus through praying for them and ministering to them. Christians are meant to display the power of Jesus through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We are meant to reveal Jesus to people in the same way he revealed himself to us. But sadly, one of the greatest challenges facing the church today is that even though Jesus has left us with this mission, the devil is more passionate about his mission to bring God's world to ruin and send people into damnation than most Christians are about the message of Jesus. Did you hear me there? Satan is more passionate about his mission to bring God's world to ruin and send people to hell than many Christians are about the mission of Jesus. Now, I'm not talking about all Christians, but many of us, we spend our lives doing very little to oppose the devil's plan or share with people that Jesus can save them. I want to end this message today by looking at the response of the two disciples when they came to believe, when they realized who Jesus was. It says in verse 32, they said to each other, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" And within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem. Now, these guys, they'd left Jerusalem because to stay there was dangerous. They risked death because they had been followers of Jesus who was killed. And when they thought that Jesus had just been a man who died and who'd failed them, the only option seemed to run and hide and get to safety. But when their hearts burned within them in the presence of their risen Lord and loving Savior, they didn't hesitate, because there was no option but to return to the place of danger and declare so that everyone would know that Jesus is alive. Church, your mission this week is to defy the devil's plans by telling those who don't yet know, Jesus is alive. Tell them the evidence. Build relationships and journey with the lost and broken. Pray for people so they can know his presence and his power, and use the gifts of the Holy Spirit he's given you so that people can be set free. When you know who Jesus is, when you truly know he is the risen Son of God, the only hope for the world, your heart will burn within you, and there will be no other way to live but to declare to all of the world in every way you can that Jesus is alive. I pray that you will have courage from God this week to carry out his mission, to proclaim that Jesus is alive, that he is the only hope for the world, the way, truth, the life that takes people to God and eternity. Transformation in life today, I pray that you will have that courage, that certainty, that your heart will burn within you as the presence of God fills you and sustains you and restores you. May you know that Jesus is with you right now. May you be filled with his Holy Spirit, and may you go on the mission to defy the devil's plans and declare to all the world that Jesus is alive. God bless you. The Lord be with you. I'll see you soon.
So thank you for joining with us this morning. Really hope that you've enjoyed our service today. So just before you go, if you want to keep in contact with us during the week, come and visit us on Facebook or online on our website. It'd be great to keep connected with you. So have a great week, and we look forward to seeing you again next time. Bye.